there's something so beautiful when everything gets stripped away and it's just us and God, and there's no microphones and nothing seems to go right. So I just want to take a moment and just posture our hearts. And just let's just turn our focus on Jesus. Jesus, the only one who's worthy.
Oh, so worthy, Jesus. Oh, you are worthy, Jesus. Jesus. Oh, you are worthy, Jesus. Just sing out in your own words, in your own voice. You're so worthy, Jesus. You're so worthy, Jesus.
Darkness, you have filled me with peace. Giver of mercy, you're my help in time of need. Lord, I can't help but sing
faithful.
Faithful you are. Every curse, blessed Redeemer, you have set this captive free. Lord, I can't help but sing.
Faithful,
faithful, faithful you are.
I'm Thank you.
this really old song came on, and it brought me back to that place where you just realize your need for a Savior. And so it just was on my heart this week that I need you more than I needed you yesterday. I need you. And I just wanted to invite you guys into that place, especially in this season right now. We're all in need of Him. We're all in need of a Savior.
I need you more. More than yesterday, I need you more. More than words can say, I need you more than ever before. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord.
Let's sing that again.
I need you. Song I sing, more than the next heartbeat, and more than anything, Lord, as time goes by, I'll be by your side. 'Cause I never want to go back to my old. Song I sing, more than the next heartbeat, and more than anything, Lord, as time goes by, I'll be by your side. 'Cause I never want to go back to my. By your
Continue our series on holy violence. Jesus said, from the days of John till now, the kingdom of heaven suffers by violence and the violent take it by force. And the theme has been, God dropped this in my heart months ago when I saw the direction our country was going. He said, it's going to take a different kind of Christianity to see victory with what's coming against the church and against the kingdom, a holy violence. Tonight, I want to talk about Red Sea Redux. You say, what's Redux? I love this little word. I don't use it much, but a Redux means to be brought back or revived. It means restored to life and vigor, to feel revived hope. And the reason I settled on this was in the midst of all of the bad news and the fake news, many of God's prophets are declaring that God is lining us up for a spiritual repetition of Israel's great deliverance at the Red Sea. And if this is true, I would say let his people rejoice and let his enemies beware. And I want to look at some spiritual lessons tonight, God helping us, from the miracle at the Red Sea. I think you'll see some parallels to where we are. God has a threefold purpose then, and I believe now, to deliver his people, to destroy his enemies, and to glorify his name. And here was his plan in accomplishing the purpose then and now. He would lead his people into a perilous predicament. He would actually himself lead his people into a place like we're experiencing. He would entice our enemies to a furious attack. We'll see that. And work a mighty miracle to accomplish his purpose. Now, I believe in a prophetic perspective, number one and two have already occurred. I believe God has led us where we are, and I believe that our enemies are stirred up to come after us. And I believe part three is coming, a Red Sea Redux. Let me cover these. It was God who led them into the perilous predicament at the Red Sea. This is often overlooked. In Exodus 14, where the story is found, the first two verses, now the Lord spoke to Moses and said, tell the sons of Israel to turn back and camp between Pi-Hahiroth, between Migdol and the sea. You shall camp in front of Baal Zephon, opposite by the sea. You shall camp by the sea. Now, why would God lead his people into such a place that is such a stupid place to be from a military or strategic standpoint? God tells them why in the next two verses. For Pharaoh will say of the sons of Israel, when he hears that they're up against the Red Sea, they're wandering aimlessly in the land. The wilderness has shut them in. And God says, I will harden Pharaoh's heart and he will chase after them. And I will be honored through Pharaoh and all his army. And the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord. So God has led his people into this perilous place so that their enemies would think that they would be an easy prey. And I truly believe there are forces at work that see the predicament that we're in, and it has encouraged them to attack us furiously and come after us in ways we've not seen before. Verses 5-7, when the king of Egypt was told the people had fled, Pharaoh and his servants had a change of heart. Remember, they sent them out after the Passover. They were glad to get rid of them. And said, what is this we've done that we let Israel go from serving us? So he made his chariot ready and took his people with him. And he took 600 select chariots and all the other chariots of Egypt with officers over all of them. And the Lord did harden the heart of Pharaoh. And he chased after the sons of Israel as they were going out boldly. And then the Egyptians chased after them with all the horses and chariots of Pharaoh, his horsemen and his army, and they overtook them camping by the sea. So here's the situation. God has led them out of Egypt into the first part of the wilderness. They have come to the Red Sea. There are mountains on both sides. They are hemmed in. And now they look around and they see all of these horsemen and chariots coming after them. And if there is going to be, according to the prophets, a redux of this situation today, spiritually speaking, there's some things we need to know from the story. Well, the sort of Red Sea rules. There's a little book on that I'll quote from later. We need to remember, beloved, that God is sovereign. God is in charge. It is God who has put us in the straight place we're in, and it is God who has stirred up our enemies to think they can destroy us. Matthew Henry, the great Puritan, said, where they had been at Etham, there was no sea in their way to obstruct their passage. But now God himself orders them into straits, which might give them an assurance that when his purposes were served, he would without fail bring them out of those straits. God sometimes raises difficulties in the way of salvation of his people, that he may have the glory of subduing them and helping his people over them. Adam Clark says, God himself brought them into the straits from which no human power or art could extricate them. They had been an open country where they had room either to fight or fly, but now they have the Red Sea before them, Pharaoh and his host behind them, and on their right and left hand, the fortresses of the Egyptians to prevent their escape. Nor had they one boat or transport prepared for the passage. If they're to be saved, the arm of the Lord must be seen, and the vanity of the Egyptian idols be demonstrated. By bringing them into such a situation, God took from them all hope of human help and gave their adversaries every advantage against them. Has there ever been a time, spiritually speaking, where we've been in a spot like what we're in today? And I want to tell you the news, if you watch the news, the fake news, the media news, there is no good news. It is all bad. I mean, according to them, according to many of the politicians, even supposedly many of our friends, it's over. The election's over. Their man's going in. Trouble's coming. There is no pathway, hello, to victory. This is what we're hearing. But I'm hearing prophetic voices. And I don't know if you follow the prophets, but there are many, many respected prophetic voices in this nation. And they're all, for a change, saying the same thing. And beloved, I will just say it this way. This is not over. We must not give up. We must not stop believing. We must stand in faith. You say, but look at everything. It's all but done. I mean, they're measuring the drapes. I mean, here comes, all these new cabinet members and all these new agendas and all of that. Beloved, this is not worse than what they had. Believe it looked like it was all over. But if God, Matthew Henry says, if God himself brings his people into straits, he will himself discover a way to bring them out again. In times of great difficulty and great expectation, it is our wisdom to keep our spirits calm, quiet, and sedate, for then we are in the best frame, both to do our own work and to consider the work of God. A second Red Sea rule I find here is that God uses times like these to test faith. I saw a prophecy last week from Pastor Kent Christmas. He says, this is not about the election. Oh, that's so true. It's so much bigger than that. God is revealing who has faith and who does not. Many are looking at the waves and sinking. Faith is only revealed when it's put in the fire. The last move of God was about those who had gifts This move of God will be about those who have faith. I'm taking the fence down, God says, the fence that many have been riding. You see, beloved, I'll tell you, I've been telling you this all year, this pandemic, these lockdowns, and the seeming socialistic takeover of America is exposing people who have fear and people who have faith. He goes on, you're getting ready to see people who ride the fence that we thought were believers. They're going to swing to the other side and really begin to stand for the side of evil and against the side of righteousness. And God is going to uncover them. And this is exactly what happened at the Red Sea in verse 10. And as Pharaoh drew near, the sons of Israel looked, and behold, the Egyptians were marching after them, and they became very frightened. So the sons of Israel cried out to the Lord. Now, it's a good thing if you're frightened to cry out to the Lord, but unfortunately, next verses, they attacked the leader. Verses 11 to 12, and they said to Moses, is it because there were no graves in Egypt that you've taken us away to die in this wilderness? Why have you dealt with us this way, bringing us out of Egypt? Is this not the word that we spoke to you in Egypt when we said, leave us alone that we may serve the Egyptians? For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness. Oh my God, a Red Sea moment exposes those among us who are ready to go back to the way it's been, back to Egypt. I mean, translation, we'd rather die as slaves than face death as free men. God is using this moment of crisis to identify who's who. And beloved, I have been heartbroken to see what's gone on in the body of Christ. I'm talking people I have respected, people I have learned from, people who have been a blessing to my life. Like noted pastor and author Tim Keller, a great pastor up in New York State. But this noted pastor now is saying that capitalism is just as unbiblical as socialism, according to Scripture. Brother, you are a smart man, smarter than me, but you're wrong on this one. That is simply not true. Another brother I've admired is popular theologian and author John Piper. He now says he's baffled at how Christians believe the sins of President Trump in his self-exalting boastfulness are not just as bad as those of Joe Biden with his support of abortion on demand. He believes Trump's behavior has pointed the nation to destruction of more kinds than we can imagine. Can you believe that a man of God who knows the word would say that the sins of President Trump are just as bad or worse than the sins of someone who is a supporter of abortion? So, brother, you reject a president who stands against abortion because you don't like his tweets, I guess. One of the worst offenders is popular Bible teacher Beth Moore, a former supporter of President Trump, who's now turned on him. She says, quote, I don't believe these are days for mincing words. I'm 63 and a half years old, and I've never seen anything in the United States of America I have found more astonishingly seductive and dangerous to the saints than Trumpism. This Christian nationalism is not of God. Move back from it. Trumpism? Christian nationalism? Friend, I'm a patriot, but I'm a kingdom man first. I don't look to Donald Trump to save me. I don't even know what Trumpism is. Apparently, there's some sort of a concern out there by these deluded brothers and sisters that we're in danger if we support the president and love our country. Beth, have you so soon forgotten the 8 years of globalist policies we had to go through under Barack Obama? So now you're ready to go back to those who will take us into socialism? These notable leaders are the tip of the iceberg, beloved. Pastors and Christians who seem ready to turn on God like they turned on Moses, ready to go back to Egypt. 1 Corinthians 11:19. Paul says, for there must be factions among you. There must be divisions. There must be these kinds of falling out. Why? He says, in order that those who are approved may become evident among you. This is exactly what is happening today. God is using this Red Sea moment for the church in America to expose who's who, to let us see who's on board, who's riding the fence and who's not, who's standing for God and who is in fear and ready to give up. Some among us bemoan the division we see, but I'm telling you, it's not all bad. Gary DeMar says, the country is divided in one good way. It is good to know who the wolves are. They've been hiding among the sheep for a long time. And we are following a pattern that I believe is going to continue. Let's get to the miracle itself, the Red Sea, verses 13 and 14. And Moses said to the people, don't be afraid. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. He will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall see again no more forever. The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace. Matthew Henry said, Pharaoh, I love this. Pharaoh has a design to ruin Israel. Therefore, God has a design to ruin Pharaoh. Moses assures them that God will deliver them and utterly ruin their pursuers. The Lord will fight for you. This Moses was confident of himself and would have them to be so, them to be confident too, though as yet he knew not how or which way it would be brought to pass. See, this is what faith is. When you can't see, you don't walk by sight. You must walk by faith. When you get to the place where you need deliverance, you need help, but you don't see any way. There's no human way possible. You can see a path. But friends, that is the place where where Moses was. It's, I believe it's where we are. We don't need to see the way. God knows he will bring it to pass. Many of God's prophets are saying the same thing today. Don't be afraid. Stand still. See the salvation of the Lord. He will fight for us. God is about to save his people and destroy his enemies. It seems we come to our personal version of the Red Sea. We feel cornered, threatened by an enemy that hates us. We keep looking for some good news. Every day I get up, I turn on the news. I say, maybe I'll just watch for a minute and see if there's any. And there's not. Goes in, day out. Anybody else like me? Moses says, stand still. And then he only for a moment, stand still to hear instructions. Then he says, go forward. Look, verses 15, 16. Then the Lord said to Moses, why are you crying out to me? Tell the sons of Israel to go forward. And as for you, lift up your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it. And the sons of Israel will go through the midst of the sea on dry land. And as for me, behold, I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so that they will go in after them. And I will be honored through Pharaoh and all his army, through his chariots and horsemen. And then the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord when I am honored through Pharaoh, through his chariots and his horsemen. Beloved, this is as good as it gets. God is it. Go forward. This is the message to the church for 2021. Go forward. The time for passivity, the time to be on the defense is past. We have tried to get along. We have tried to compromise. We have tried to be nice. And look where it's gotten us, because we don't realize we have an enemy that is not going to allow us peace. They will not rest. It'd be like being in a fight and you just say, well, I'm just going to turn the other cheek. Well, you can turn the other cheek and they'll kill you eventually. See, what works in a situation of one-on-one, like for the Sermon on the Mount, turn the other cheek as a principle, doesn't apply when it's attack on the nation itself, when it's attack on the kingdom of God, the body of Christ. I just think this is a, Matthew Henry said, let the children of Israel go as far as they can on dry ground, and then God will divide the sea and open a passage for them through it. God plans not only to deliver the Israelites, but destroy the Egyptians and counsels them accordingly. How easily, Adam Clark says, can God make the same thing an instrument of destruction or salvation as seems best to his godly wisdom? He alone can work by all agents and produce any kind of effect, even by the same instrument, for all things serve the purposes of his will. What's he talking about? He's talking about the Red Sea. He says, I'm going to use the Red Sea two ways. It's going to be a way of deliverance for my people and a way of destruction for my enemy. See, the very thing that seems to be holding us back in the hands of God becomes a double-edged sword, and it's going to come and cut. And I'm standing to see that happen. I am not persuaded that God is going to allow this nation to be taken over by his enemies. We have a covenant with God. We were established in God, by God, through God, dedicated for God. And we are all the nations of the world, as sinful and as defective as we are, still to the world represent the Christian message and the gospel of Jesus Christ. And you can go anywhere in the world. I've been to all the nations, but I've been to a few, and I'm telling you, everywhere you go, it's automatic that people recognize if you're from America, you're probably a Christian person. And God is not going to let us down. Moses stretched his hand over the sea, verses 21 to 23, and the Lord swept the sea back by a strong east wind all night and turned the sea into dry land, so the waters were divided. And you know the story. The sons of Israel went through the midst of the sea on dry land with the waters like a wall on their right or left. I've seen the movie, and you know, they've done this a couple of times, and it's very impressive, but it still doesn't quite get what must have looked like to have two 45-foot high walls of jello on both sides, standing there where the ground is not even wet, and you're walking through that. Beloved, if the God of the Bible is our God, and he could do this in the natural, he can certainly do the same thing in the spiritual and see his people through. And the Lord said to Moses, stretch your hand over the sea, that the waters may come back upon the Egyptians on their chariots and on their horsemen. And Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. And when the morning appeared, the sea returned to full depth while the Egyptians were fleeing into it. So the Lord overthrew the Egyptians in the midst of the sea. Then the waters returned and covered the chariots and the horsemen and all the army of Pharaoh that came into the sea after them. Not so much as one of them remained. But the children of Israel walked on dry land in the midst of the sea, and the waters were a wall to them. The historian Josephus tells us, just so you get an idea of the magnitude here, that the army of Pharaoh consisted of 50,000 horses and 200,000 foot soldiers, not one of whom remained. Now, I love horses. I don't love them as much as Chris Vaughn loves them, but I love horses. It troubles me to think that we have 50,000 horses that drown, and even though they're sinners and enemies of God, 200,000 foot soldiers, this was a massive move of the warrior God, who is the Lord of hosts. This is holy violence. This is not the God who has a lamb under one arm and a light bulb behind his head, you know, over the other, and a nice little shepherd's crook. No, this is the Lord of hosts. Hallelujah. Exodus 14, 30 and 31. So the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. And thus Israel saw the great work which the Lord had done in Egypt. And so two things: the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and his servant Moses. And this is going to be the outcome of this. Beloved, I am persuaded between now and the end of next month, we're going to witness something like this in the spirit realm. I am totally persuaded something is going to happen. It makes no sense in the natural. You can't see it. It's like, I don't know how. But remember that God is lining us up for a spiritual repetition of Israel's great deliverance at the Red Sea. He still has the same purpose today he had then. He wants to deliver his people, destroy his enemies, and glorify his name. And he's going to do it the same way, put us in a place of peril, entice the enemies to attack us, and then work a mighty miracle that accomplishes the purpose. Now, here's the key to the story, my favorite part. God led his people into the sea. He exposed those who had faith and those who had fear, but he had a plan in mind the whole time. The key to the story is in a passage from Psalms. And this, I have to tell you, is one of my favorite Psalm passages. It's just a little phrase, but I saw this years ago, and it's taken Elizabeth and me through some terrible times of Red Sea type moments, where we have been at a place where we were in such trouble, we were under such attack, we had no idea of how to get out of it. Have you ever been at a place where you sit there and you kind of pray and you stare at the wall and you're in a bind and your mind will begin to give options? You know, well, you could try that. Well, you could downsize the house. Well, you could mortgage one of the kids. You could do this, you could do that. And so your mind starts going through these avenues of escape and you go, well, that won't work, that won't work, that won't work. And after you go through enough of those, you come to the end where there's nothing. This is nothing. You don't see a way. Well, here's what the psalmist said. Looking back on this incident, Psalm 77, verses 16, 18, set it up. When the Red Sea saw you, O God, its waters looked and trembled. The sea quaked to its very depths. The clouds poured down rain. The thunder rumbled in the sky. Your arrows of lightning flashed. Your thunder roared from the whirlwind. The lightning lit up the world. The earth trembled and shook. That's a prophetic picture of exactly what's happening today. The world, the sea, which prophetically often is speaks of the nation, looks up and, man, they see God is moving and there's lightning and there's thunder and there's all kinds of activity. The earth is trembling and shaking. It's happening again. And here's the verse I love, verses 19 to 20. You led your people through the sea, your pathway through the mighty waters, a pathway no one knew was there. There is a pathway no one knows is there. Beloved, you can watch the news. You can even watch the good news. You can listen to people that are pro-God, and they will give you little scenarios. But I'm telling you, they may not know. There is a way no one can know. No one can figure out. I would not be surprised to see God do something nobody has even thought of. You know, I hear that, well, there's still a pathway to victory for the president this way or that way. And maybe there's only one or two options left. And they're long shots. Everybody says, well, that's a long shot. I'm going to tell you something. God knows a way through this thing that is not going to fail. There is a way through this that will work. But it's a pathway no one knew was there. You led your people along that road like a flock of sheep with Moses and Aaron as their shepherds. See, the media says there's no path. There's no path to victory. And so Israel could see no escape, but God saw something. It's just so amazing to me that when God's looking down and he sees the whole thing, beloved, he sees everything. He sees his people threatened and afraid. He sees them cornered. He sees them trapped. He sees the enemy army like a massive army. Now, these Israelites, I mean, how many of you know they've been slaves for 430 years? They don't have any swords and shields. They don't have any of that stuff. Here comes armed soldiers and chariots of war. And God sees all this. And he looks at the whole thing. And the Israelites looking around, how are we going to get out of this? But God looks through the waters. God sees the path that no one can see. And there is a path. I believe you. Charles Spurgeon said once, the Lord will make a way for you where no foot has been before. That which, like the sea, threatens to drown you shall become a highway for your escape. We have too many testimonies over the years from God to believe he'll not take a hand in our situation now. Isaiah 43, 19, God says, I will make a way in the wilderness. I will make rivers in the desert. And 1 Corinthians 10, 13, We are told that God is faithful no matter what temptation or trial we're going through. When we are tested, the Bible says he will make a way of escape. God will make a way where there seems to be no way. Isabel Kuhn was a missionary back in the early 20th century. She said, I have found that if we go as far as we can, God opens up the rest of the way. And in his little book, Red Sea Rules, Robert J. Morgan says, God did not remove the Red Sea, he opened it. He will find a way to help us through our problems as well. God has not brought us out into this Red Sea, edge of the Red Sea to drown us. We just need faith. A.W. Tozer said to the child of God, there's no such thing as an accident. He travels in an appointed way. Accidents may appear to befall him and misfortune stalk his way, but those evils will be so in appearance only and will seem evils only because we cannot read the secret script of God's hidden providence. God is the God of providence. He provides. I love to teach on the providence of God. It's formed from two words, pro, meaning before or ahead, and video, which means to see. Providence means to see ahead. God sees ahead. God sees ahead perfectly. We only see ahead slightly. You know, when you send your children off to school and you make a lunch for them, you are providing. What are you doing? You are foreseeing a need they don't have yet. You know at noon they're going to be hungry. So you are seeing ahead and providing. I'm telling you, we could not come to any place of straits or tightness or peril. There's no place that we could ever come to that God, our God, has not foreseen that place and made a provision to meet the need in that place when we get there. You ever pack for a vacation and you say, well, I'm going to Florida. So you pack all your shorts and everything. And then you get down there and you find out you forgot your beach towel or your sunglasses. You know, that's because you're human. You foresee some things, but God doesn't leave anything out. You can never come into a situation and find yourself in a place where you say, well, I need that. Oh, God says, oh, I missed that. Oh, I forgot you were going to need that. It's impossible. See, the great C.H. McIntosh said, if we could only look upon a difficult crisis as an occasion of bringing out on our behalf the sufficiency of divine grace, it would enable us to preserve the balance of our souls and glorify God even when we're in the deepest waters. And here's one more thing, and I believe this is prophetic. This is a little something God did when the Egyptians were chasing after his people. And it's back in verse 25. And God took off their chariot wheels, so they drove them with difficulty. Other versions say God made the wheels of their chariots come off. Another version says he twisted their chariot wheels, making their chariots difficult to drive. Another version says, and he caused the chariot wheels to swerve, and he made them drive with difficulty. I'm speaking this prophetically over the enemies of God. God is going to take, he's going to make your chariot wheels go square. You think you've got an easy path, but I've got news for you. God is on the job. God is going to, you've got these vehicles that you're driving that you think will destroy God's people, that you think will set his church back. I'm telling you, we've got a God in heaven that looks at your little wheels you're rolling on, and he knows how to make them swerve. And I'm telling you, you're going to see some of these people turn on each other like these armies did in the Old Testament when God would confuse them. And then all of a sudden, Israel is just sitting there because they're killing themselves. These people are going to kill themselves. They're going to turn on each other. You're going to see a war on the other side between the members of the other side. It's coming. It's already, actually, it's begun. And we're going to see more of it. God has a plan for our deliverance. No one knows. God makes a way where there seems to be no way, and he delivers his people while he destroys his enemies. And when it's all over, and I'll close with this, chapter 14 goes right into chapter 15. The whole chapter is called the Song of Moses. The Song of Moses. And I declare this is the song we will be singing as his church in the coming months, we will be singing this song when we see the deliverance of God and what he is going to do. It starts off with verses 1 and 2. And then Moses and the children, when? Then is when all of this has happened and the enemies are destroyed and God's people are saved. Then Moses and the children of Israel sang this song to the Lord and spoke, saying, I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and its rider he has thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and song, and he has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will praise him, my father's God, and I will exalt him. And then verse 3, the Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name. Pharaoh's chariots and his army he has cast into the sea. His chosen captains are drowned in the Red Sea. The depths have covered them. They sink to the bottom like a stone. Hallelujah. I am expecting God to show up in a mighty way. He has not changed. Too many Christians somehow have bifurcated the personage of God. They think the God of the Old Testament was mean and vindictive and angry and warlike, but the God of the New Testament, you know, wouldn't hurt a fly, wouldn't hurt a flea, wouldn't bother anybody, wouldn't upset anybody's plans. But the only problem with that is the Bible says, God says, I am the Lord, I change not. God is the same. The only reason people split up God is because they're too lazy to study the word. There is no contradiction in the nature of God. He can be a man of war and the God who is love at the same time without any contradiction. And what we need is a revelation, a fresh revelation of a God who's bigger than the God that we've been preaching in the nation that's gotten us into this mess. And God will deliver us. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Father, we agree with what has happened. We believe a redux is coming. We believe there's going to be a revival of things that happened before when you showed yourself to your people in a mighty way. God, we're expecting, we're believing. We speak to our fear, be still. We speak to our faith, rise up. Our faith in you, God, is greater than our fear of the enemy and what he might do. I pray a blessing upon the Church of Jesus Christ. I'm talking about the true church. I thank you, God, you're separating wheat and tares. I thank you're exposing wolves, false prophets, false brothers. I thank you, God, you're shutting down some of these churches. They need to be shut down. And I say, Lord, any pastor that cannot do services and shuts his church down for months because the government said so needs to find another job and get out of the ministry. And I pray, God, there will be a backbone, a new backbone that's distributed, that's dealt out to the body of Christ, especially the leaders, Lord, those of us who bear the responsibility, that we would stand strong, not be afraid, Lord, not be threatened, but that we would take our place on your side, in your word, in Jesus' name. Amen.